Well, hello everyone for the last time at here at the grid stage. Our last speaker for tonight is Robert Nemet, so give it up for him.
Thank you. Let's talk about metrics and event-driven systems. I was thinking how to start this, and I'll start this with one personal story. This year, I had some health issues, and I went to the doctor, and the doctor sent me to do some tests, and I did some tests. They find something, okay? Let's repeat this after a couple of days, and then next week, and next week, and next week. And they found what is wrong with me, and they gave me therapy, and then we monitor and do all the stuff like we all do when we go to doctors, and that's all fine. And then what I'm doing is like kind of SRE guy in one company. We're gonna skip this. This is not much important. And we are working with event-driven systems. We are serving a bunch of customers. And we're doing what exactly doctors are doing. We are measuring stuff in our system to figure out what's wrong, to understand better our system. But there's so much things to measure. There's so much thing together to pull and figure out what's wrong, what are the trends, what is the key metric to figure out our system behavior, is it good or wrong? And this is when we hit a kind of a bottleneck, like what should I measure? And first to start with that, we need to define this event-driven systems. And what you can say about this, event-driven system is like a software. In what we are doing is a system of software system which components communicate by consuming and producing different kind of events. And we see this in our industry, in this in real-time systems, IoT systems, microservices. Most of us, I guess, we are in these microservices. And then we need to define one more thing, what is a metric. And basically, since the dawn of humankind, we measure stuff, and the metric would be like a measurement. It's a quantitative attribute. It has a name, it has its value, and it has a moment when we measure it, because things change over time. You grow, right? And then over time, when you are 6 years old, you're, I don't know, 1 meter high. 6 months later, you are 1 meter and 5 centimeters, for example. This is like a measurement. And this moment is very important, because this is when the information is created, and it gives it value, or, I mean, the value, the context value. Is it important or it is not important? Is it in the past, and who cares about it? And in our industry, we have this one more thing that we all see, that adding the context, that these kind of systems can add additional attributes or dimensions to this metric, so we can better understand it. We come to this. So why do we need metrics? We want metrics so that, and as I said, we want to understand how our system behaves. Is it healthy or is it not healthy? And where is it going? How is it? Is it under the stress or is it not under the stress? Think, for example, the people who are in sports, the boxers, for example, when they are hitting each other, they are under the stress. So this threshold, the body gives them, when they receive the hit, they receive this signal, and the brain can measure the stress of pain and say, okay, I need to do this and this. So basically on this, by this metric, you defined your behavior. And this defines sorry. So this defines how you're gonna behave and how you're gonna act according to all these metrics. So what we are doing is, I just mentioned a couple of the things here that we cannot, in event-driven systems, we cannot debug as we used to in the old systems. We cannot look at the logs because we are producing too much logs, and then we need additional tools to understand what's going on. And so messy, we cannot do that anymore. And then we can do the load tests, for example, to test our system, to get some kind of idea what's going on, but it's not a real situation. I mean, the real situation usually happens when you're not at work during the weekend and your site is hit with a lot of traffic and you need to figure out on the Monday what went wrong or what could go wrong and how you want to prevent that next time so you can sleep easily. And as well, that goes even beyond that, because then you need to make decisions and you need to make plans, and that plans be like, should I improve my system or should I cut out something of my system? And all those metrics as well, you will see when you do this, you repeat some stuff, and when you repeat some stuff, you're gonna automate it. And since everything is quantified, because of the, how we do it, we can automate these answers. For example, I think that already someone mentioned, like in microservice world, we have this HPA. HPA is a good example of automatic decision making. You have some kind of metrics, you can create some formula according to these metrics, and you said it goes above the thresholds, scale up, it goes down, scale down, that's it. And then, yeah, so these are those examples. And you probably already saw this. So scaling, yeah, alerting. So if something really goes down, you need to make a decision to call someone or not. You won't alert every time when you see some error. You will wait that this error threshold holds up, and then you're gonna call somebody during the night and say, yeah, we need to do something about it. And if this repeats, then yeah, maybe you're gonna create some automatic tool that's gonna fix this thing that goes bad every time. And then this is a thing that is like a big problem, because in our event-driven systems, we have so many, when you start building the system, every subsystem of that system will produce metrics. There will be so many metrics that you're going to start thinking, okay, how? What should I measure? I mean, it's a sea, it's ocean of metrics, and you look at them and you're basically start to be confused. What should I use? How should I find the things that I should look at and drop everything else because it doesn't help me, it just spams me and kills me. And this is how we can do that. It's basically dividing our system in the different subsystems and look every subsystem with look at those characteristics of those subsystems, and then based on that, those characteristics of the system subsystems, we can choose the metrics that will tell us how this subsystem behaves and what should I do with it. As well, it is important how often I do measurement. If you want to look if your site behaves good or not, you're gonna look at the errors and you're gonna look at it very often. But on the other side, if you see that your site is behaving fine and your services are behaving fine, but you see that the threshold of some components are close to the it is really close to what you defined over a long period of time, maybe then you need to do something about it. This is like if you're looking at the CPU usage or memory, for example, you won't measure that every 5 seconds. You won't look at it every second. You're going to look at it over a week, or maybe even for the longer period. Maybe not all, like a week, it's a good enough, weekends especially. And then you will see if it's close to the maximum resources that you define, for example, I don't know, 90%, you can say, okay, maybe I should give it a bit more, so I'm going to reconfigure my services to get breed more next time. In general, I think it's good that we think, when we think about the subsystems of event-driven systems, that we split them in two kinds or two groups. One would be user-facing systems. So these are like web servers, the front ends that directly talk to the users, and the measurements that we then measure to the metrics that we take then is completely different from the systems that are not user-facing systems. Like, I don't know, streaming subsystems. I put something here, but when you think about all these streaming, they're not only Apache, for example. It always goes with some backend service that do something with your message, that reads and process them and put them back or put them into database, etc. Same goes with the databases. Why this is important? Because you want that your users will be satisfied, and the things that you can do are different. It's not the same action that you will do when you're facing the issues on user-facing system and non-user-facing system. You're going to react differently. The solutions will be differently. So we need to, because of that, measure stuff differently. And in user-facing systems, as I said, this should be more oriented toward the user experience. So all these things, all these four things like request duration rate, request rate, request size, and error rate, these are basically, when you think about it, this is what is important for your user. Your user wants to know, because of his experience, he needs fast requests. The latency needs to be slow. The rate is very important, how low your server can handle. The message size, it really does matter. You don't want to wait for something to load for a couple of seconds. You just need, I don't know, half a second max. That's it. And then an error rate. If error happens, then you need to repeat an action. And of course, you don't want to do that. In non-user-facing systems, all these metrics that we are measuring, they are more oriented toward the system stability and efficiency. And because of this we have like a number of incoming messages, number of stored messages, sent messages, message size, errors again, number of queries, query duration, depends, is it a streaming system or is it a database? But more or less, it's the same. And then, on historically looking, we have something that are common metrics, and the common metrics are metrics that are coming from the computer systems, like this CPU usage, memory usage, disk usage, and network usage. But as you see, for example, if you look these metrics, they are not important for user-facing systems. Why do you care about CPU usage for the front end? Who cares about it? User doesn't care about it. He just needs to get the content fastest. So fast as possible and look at it and act on it. Memory, who cares about it, right? And then when we look all these metrics and tries to crunch it, and according to all these subsystems that we said, non-user-facing and non-user-facing subsystems, and let's try to put some methodologies there, and define some key metrics. This is, these four things would be like a matrix that we should look at, and based on those metrics and based on the subsystems, we should measure them and implement them in our system. This would be like latency or duration. We can say that this is the time or distribution of time needed to complete an action. Usually in practice, whoever uses, for example, Prometheus, you know about histograms. So we use this. Then a traffic rate. This is the, again, distribution number of actions per time. Errors. Again, errors everywhere, right? Distribution of errors, again, per time. Because you will not have a lot of errors when you don't have a traffic. But when you have a lot of traffic and you have a lot of errors, they're quite common. Then saturation. The saturation is kind of, let's say, tricky. This is the level of your resource can be used. And this one, I'm going to talk about this one as well, because it could be understood in two ways. And based on all this, there are a couple of methods. One of the methods that are more, I think it's more simple method, I saw it on Waveworks, I think they promoted the first one, is oriented only to the user-facing systems. It's simple, it's good, because when you create those, when you measure those metrics for the by the red method, you will be able to template everything. So when you create dashboards, for example, in Grafana, every service that you put in your system will have this dashboard automatically. And for you, it will be very easy to see and understand what's going on. And what is the rate? So it goes like, what's the rate of requests? Again, rate traffic, errors, and duration. And the red is because of rate, error, duration, the first capital letters. And this is what you need to know about your user-facing system. Simple. And I think it's common sense in this regard. For this, in practice, as I mentioned, Prometheus, you're going to probably use histograms, and you can get everything from there. The next thing is the used method by Brandon Gregg. It's a bit older thing when we didn't have microservices, if I'm not wrong, and they're more oriented to the core computer systems. And because of that, it has some bit different definitions and have this thing called utilization. And this is why it has called the use, like, what is the utilization, what is the rate of errors, and what is the saturation? Oh, it should be like, first, what is the saturation, then what is the rate of error, and then you get the use, right? And the utilization in his method is like utilization of CPU, utilization of your memory, utilization of your disk. And this is important when you're dealing with, for example, systems with databases, like databases and machines that are running your databases. Because in this case, if you fill your disk, if your utilization of disk is 90%, that's it. I mean, you're going to fill your disk in the next, I don't know, 2 hours. Right? So you need to think about that in advance. And this is a bit different to the, as I said, already talked about this utilization. This is a bit to the different from the next method that I'm going to cover. And the next one is the one that is defined by Google. It's called forgotten synchronous. This would be like for me like red method plus saturation. But there is a small difference. And this one tried to address user and non-user facing systems. And in this case, and this is common because the Google basically provide only services. And when you build your system and you look at the services, and they can scale up whenever they want, right? So in their case, saturation doesn't have the same meaning as a previous method, because they can scale up and they can say that you can, when you saturate your service, they can expand it. For example, if you're using the database in a Google system, you can configure it to expand the disk. So as long as you have money, you have a budget, you will not have an issue with the disk. So what they defined is the latency. Again, it's distribution time to distribute. The distribution time to take to complete an action, same for the traffic, errors, and saturation as in the previous methods. And the difference between, as I said, in the use method and the Google for signals is that here the level, they define this as a level which resource can be used, which is more like utilization in a use method, because you cannot utilize, in use method, you cannot utilize more than 100%. When you reach the 100%, that's it. And in use, the saturation is a level which resource can have to do extra work. And that would mean that even if you have more work to do, it will be put in some queue, and eventually, if this queue is filled, then it will be dropped. But otherwise, it will be done eventually. And then, which method to use? As I said, probably you're gonna use either four golden signals, or, which I think it's better, to divide your system in different subsystems, and then try to choose the proper metrics to understand your subsystem and create around that subsystem the right metrics so you can do your alerting, your your planning, and whatever other stuff that you are doing by those systems. And then, as I said, just combine them all, and there is no basically silver bullet for all this stuff. So, yeah, and I think that's it. Yeah. Any questions?
Hey, thanks for the presentation. I just have a quick question.
Yeah.
Do you have any recommendation of policy or strategy to set up thresholds for SLAs and SLOs? Because in most of the times they're quite tightly connected with the like the errors and monitoring.
Yes.
The same metrics, but we need different thresholds for them. So it's sometimes it's a bit fuzzy, like how you should set that up. There are many different propositions. So I would like to know if you have some by experience that you would recommend.
Actually, I don't have any recommendations for this. It's, I mean, the SLOs and SLAs, it depends on a subsystem and what you want to achieve, what it provides to the end user. And then based on that, you can define those thresholds. I mean, usually we work with a team to define this, what's their goal. And then we can define it. But basically, all from all these four metrics, the saturation rate, the utilization saturation, traffic rate, error rate, it comes. I mean, there are the four metrics that you look, you calculate basically everything from there, and then you calculate the SLOs, SLAs, whatever other stuff you want. I mean, some systems provide some specific systems that you can, some custom metrics. We have this issue with high peak of high load peaks in very short time, and we couldn't get it with just what we had in past, so we had to look at the metrics that, because it was the front end that Node.js provided automatically, and then use them to replace what we had, because the reaction then was better.
Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Are there any other questions? Thank you, Robert.
Thank you.